to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Mrs. Mayor, if you do the roll call, please.
I'd be happy to. Cullen Trivett.
Here.
I woke you up, didn't I? Lisa Collins.
Here.
Gary Dunlap.
Here.
Joe Gittens.
Here.
Cheryl Hancock.
Here.
Anita Dushay-Kosinski.
Here.
Kate Mayer, I'm here, and Tim Miniger.
He is excused.
All right, thank you.
Okay, with six of the seven school board members present, I would declare a quorum. Approval of the agenda. I would note that the agenda has been posted, is distributed, and sent to the local media. With this in mind, are there any changes to the agenda at this time? Seeing none, I would entertain a motion to approve the agenda as published. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Okay, motion has been made and seconded to approve the agenda as published. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Public participation. Is there anyone who wishes to address the board relative to any item at this time? We ask that a 5-minute time limit per person be followed. Please come forward, state your name, address, and topic to be addressed. No one is fighting their way to the front. Then we will move on to recognition and thank you, Dr. Carlson.
One thank you this evening. We thank the Seventh-day Adventist Church of La Crosse for the recent donation of $50. As requested, this donation will benefit the high school's drama and show choir, so their continued support is greatly appreciated. Thank you.
Thank you. Then the next item is our opportunity to visit with Senator Jennifer Schilling. Senator Schilling, if you'd come forward to the table. I think, as is our practice, if you want to make a few opening comments or remarks, update us, and then obviously the board will have some Q&A or some questions.
Well, Happy New Year. It's always nice. I enjoy the opportunities to appear before the many school boards and school districts officials throughout the 32nd. So I think it's a good opportunity to kind of stay in touch and be able to kind of ask some questions maybe in a formal way or maybe less informal about things that are happening in Madison, kind of the time frame of things and what's happening under the dome. These days, I don't go anywhere without the education by the numbers that the La Crosse Tribune had put together, kind of a snapshot of our area per student spending highlights and talking about different opportunities and challenges that our school districts have. But I also, before I go to a school, I'd like to print out their report card. I wanted to say congratulations on the report card that Holman School District has earned with an exceeds expectations. So pleased to see that, and certainly know the commitment and the value that you and the citizens that you represent have towards public education and investing in children's education. So congratulations on that. Just, I guess, a couple things. We are starting our kind of winter / spring floor period in the legislature. So the Senate, the Assembly will be in for both January, February, and into March is kind of a holdover, and then we will probably adjourn for the year because it's an election year in 2014, November, for everyone in the State Assembly and half of the folks in the State Senate. So we have kind of a condensed time frame that we're operating under with kind of our last opportunity to get some bills passed and to look at some things that are kind of pending. Just in general, the DPI numbers that I had pulled quickly showed that Holman District would see about $500,000 in additional state aid this year, also recognizing some school districts saw a cut, and certainly $500,000 is appreciated, but in the big picture, some significant cuts and some tough decisions that you all have had to make with the Holman School District. The Assembly Committee on Common Core Standards, that's something that is like all places people are kind of wondering about what is the status of Common Core, and both the Assembly and the Senate had work groups looking at Common Core, having a hearing on it. I know on the Assembly side, some of my colleagues were a little miffed a little bit about how those hearings were held, the invited guests, and making it very difficult for people with an education background to be able to testify and share their concerns, rather giving time to some of the something through both legislatures. I think this is probably more of a discussion point, and the critics really want to raise this. So as we go into the next budget or we go into future sessions, to have some legislation drafted to address it. And as I spoke with Senator Farrell, who on the Senate side kind of was tackling his own concerns with Common Core, looking to see that there needs to be a group, maybe every 6 years or something, that is looking at some of these standards. I think he had some examples, and sometimes it might be sort of the far-reaching ones, that maybe 12-year career of a student, that none of these standards are really looked at. And if there is going to be a work group or a Blue Ribbon Commission put together, make sure we've got educators who have that background of standards to be represented, as well as some other people in there. But I know it's kind of a work in progress, that my colleagues are putting something forward. But I really don't think that partisan politicians who don't have any place in Wisconsin in evaluating those education standards. And we need to make sure that our workforce is trained and has the background that they're currently sitting in classrooms now around the state, should not be subject to political whims and extreme viewpoints in matters. I think politicizing the education standards and catering to some of those extreme political viewpoints would really compromise a student's ability to succeed. The Common Core really provides a floor and not a ceiling in the requirements of higher standards for Wisconsin children. And as I have talked with larger school districts to the smaller school districts, I was in Hillsboro before the holidays and met with their team, leadership team there, about some of the costs that already have been invested in Common Core. If it's some of the textbooks, but it's the teacher training and it's the time that has already been invested, and it's hard to sometimes put a value on that. But many school districts have already gone down this path of investing and heeding the requirements of Common Core. So the Assembly Republican recommendations, they could lead to legislation modifying or even rejecting the English and the math standards. You have to see what happens there. They also recommend passing laws to protect student privacy and restrict the collection of student biometric data, including fingerprints, retinal scans, and facial recognition is what they are talking about. Just last week on the Joint Finance Committee, I know that the Department of Public Instruction came before us with a request on the multi-vendor student data information system, and looking at what school districts are currently using, but some of the language in the state budget from last year. And some of those questions from my Republican colleagues came up about that data. What is being released and how is it being used? And some real concern there. And we really tried to keep some of the criticism of Common Core from creeping into that financial request from DPI that Tony Evers had spoken with many of us and really wanted us to go forward. I'm pleased we had the votes on the committee to move forward with a funding request for them to continue to develop that. Voucher expansion, of course, that is one also that I hear a lot about, a concern in Western Wisconsin. We, of course, will now become familiar with voucher schools now that it has been included in the state budget. And while we have the limit of 500 students the first year and the cap of 1,000 students in the second year, I fully expect my colleagues who support voucher schools to be lifting that cap in the future and in the budget, future budget. So what that means to already diminishing public school or taxpayer dollars towards our public schools, and kind of that tension that exists, that will exist with establishing kind of two or parallel education system here in the state, continues to trouble me. And certainly if we are going to go down that path, looking for some accountability measures and those same leveling the playing field, so that those private voucher schools need to follow many of the same rules and regulations that our public schools currently are. So I know that many of you are familiar with that and have contacted my office about concerns. Right now we have 20 students who are currently attending Aquinas Catholic School through the voucher program, and 9 are new to the school system, but most of the vouchers are for elementary students, so many of them are already attending. Senator Olson has a voucher accountability bill, Senate Bill 379. It has kind of been stalled in committee. I don't know now with the had it moved through the committee, but they had refused to schedule a hearing on a bill that I have introduced with Senator John Layman to look at many of the exchange criteria that the school needs to be able to certify. Over the last 10 years, there have been 49 schools who have been removed from the voucher program by DEI due to a range of issues dealing from fiscal mismanagement to lack of accreditation and fraud and health and safety concerns. So this is going to continue to be an issue that is going to be hotly debated, and that there will be tension on the expansion of vouchers this year, and we've got to know what that means to our public schools. General school aid, I know that even after the additional $100 million for that the legislature really recently provided, 11 of 18 school districts in the 32nd Senate District would see a cut in their state aid this year compared to last. So it is out getting out, talking to those superintendents and the others on their leadership team to see what they are doing, if they're having to go to a referendum, what this means for kind of the realities of state aid in education. A total of $1.6 million will be cut from the 32nd Senate District schools, with many of those school districts being forced to make sharp cuts and raise property taxes to balance their budget. So as we go into kind of the next couple weeks, we will be in session tomorrow in the Senate. It's really pretty non-controversial, many gubernatorial appointments that we're taking up, and a fix to some Badger care funding. Next week, the governor will be giving his State of the State address on Wednesday evening. I think that's the 23rd. And so, you know, I will be wanting to hear how the governor hopes to continue to keep his eye on job creation in this state and strengthening our economy and investing in worker training. We currently are 37th in the nation. I think we can do better. There are other surrounding states that are adding jobs at a quicker clip than we are. And I want to make sure that we're not stuck in neutral, that we need to continue to be moving forward. The rest of our surrounding states are moving forward. And I will really kind of have an ear on the governor's plans in that area. Also, there has been some talk that in the next couple weeks, we were going to get revenue projections will be in, and they are higher. They're expected to be higher than first projected. So many of my colleagues are banking about what can we do with that money. Tax rebate. Do we look at putting forward tax holidays, such as going back to school and a sales tax holiday or something around the holidays? Looking to put it into some of the core areas that I feel that we value in the state that we were not able to fund appropriately in the last budget. So we don't know what that number really will be right now, but there are some talk of some tax reforms coming down. It would be a tax cut that the governor is going to get behind, or something else that a plan would be coming forward from the legislature through the Senate and the Assembly. And then just finally, I think something that you will see some bipartisan support on from both houses in the next couple of weeks will be a mental health task force recommendation and several bills coming out of the Speaker's task force on mental health. It kind of came out of the Sandy Hook tragedy, and rather than looking at firearms and some background checks and things like that, really trying to look at mental health services and where there have been breakdowns in mental health services and availability. Many of those bills that will be coming through are dealing with peer respite centers, looking at crisis training for law enforcement, looking at better coordination with medical personnel, with patients, with a primary physician and a behavioral health specialist. The second package that will have broad bipartisan support will be the heroin package, or HOPE, and that area, that is a bill that will increase the use and the availability of Narcan for our first responders and other emergency personnel in the state. Also looking at helping communities look at drug disposal for narcotics in their community, setting something up, and looking at requiring a picture ID, so when you pick up narcotics or schedule some drugs at the pharmacy, you know whose hands they're going into. And then the fourth one is an immunity for people who call 911 if there is a overdose happening. So while we have, I think, a lot of challenges on our plate, those are kind of the issues a whimper than a bang than the assembly. My colleagues in the assembly need a little bit more ruckus on some of the bills that they bring forward, and the Senate tends to be a little bit more pragmatic. Now I'm going to take a breath.
Well, thank you.
I brought blue books, so hopefully all of you through our offices and Representative Doyle should have received blue books when they came out, but I have about five in a box, so if anyone would like to have a blue book or anyone from the public, I brought blue books.
Well, thank you so very much. We do appreciate your taking time. I suppose you are traveling to Madison shortly after this meeting or early tomorrow morning?
Early tomorrow. I think snow is supposed to start after.
Well, questions from the board? Any questions?
Maybe just some information for you. The WASB convention is coming up in Milwaukee, and there are many resolutions that have been brought forward for the delegates to vote on. And many of those resolutions, Jennifer, include comments about voucher schools, things that you mentioned already, but just so that you know that that assembly of people are supporting that voucher schools do need to be held to the same statutory requirements as other schools, that teachers and administrators hold the same requirements as public school teachers do, that open meeting laws not be violated. And those are just so critical in terms of as we watch this snowball rolling down the hill with more and more vouchers or more and more charters. Another issue is that concerns me is as we expand charters, the talk about public school boards not having any right to deal with schools that are set up, that private entities run those schools. And again, you combine that with closed meetings, so no one ever knows really what's going on. So those are all things that the Wisconsin Association of School Boards are backing also. And I think that's good for you to know. Your comment about Common Core, and when you mention, I think you mentioned mostly the Tea Partiers saying that they're not strict enough. Just in a sentence, educators laugh when they hear that because they're working their hind ends off because these standards are so high, as they should be. It's a ridiculous statement. Just a question, another thing that a resolution that's coming down the pack on WASB is in Milwaukee there was talk of forced sale of school facilities that are not used to their capacity, and that's a big red flag for us, and those facilities would be basically taken over for various amounts of prices, run by private entities, and all loss of school property. So that's an issue that's there.
Yeah, I think that bill actually came to one of the committees that I sit on, and we had a hearing. I think we voted it out, and I can't remember if we actually passed it to the Senate or not, but there really was some concern. As I looked at the supporters of the bill, many of them were from Milwaukee, but they were Republicans. And I said, well, how about the Democrats from from the Milwaukee area? What are their concerns there? Unfortunately, it ended up being kind of a partisan position.
Then on one other thing, weapons in school, has that been brought up yet with the right to carry? That's also a resolution being brought forward because we heard talk of people besides sworn law enforcement officers being allowed to carry, that might be a state law or there was something moving toward that.
Yeah, I think one of the assembly colleagues, Representative Joel Clayfish, may have had that amendment to a bill, and I think there was a great dust up about it, and that kind of went on the back.
Okay. 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 And then last question. I heard a couple days ago Jill Billings talking about a human trafficking law, and I went to the human trafficking conference that was held in La Crosse and was amazed to find how many high school teenagers can be involved with that. So my school board head is just wondering if that bill seems hopeful, that basically it would give some rights to these victims who don't have a voice, for one thing, but could turn around and have some litigation against people who have harmed them and such.
Yeah, I think maybe just this week, Representative Billings introduced that for civil liability, and I know some other colleagues, Representative Amy Lautenbeck, who's been doing some work on the sex trafficking bill as well as Senator, Senator Nakia Harris. So there is, has been four or five
other questions or comments?
Well, I know that just to take a minute or two to share some exciting things that are happening in Holden. At our more recent meeting, we approved the organic agriculture issues and practices course that's going to be offered in Holden and working with Organic Valley. And I know I see often when you're interacting with those folks, but Holman, we're very proud of how progressive we've been in those areas, and our agriculture programs are very up to date.
Do you have a school garden at the high school or middle school or elementary school?
Some of our elementary schools do, and I know that we have a greenhouse in the high school. Don't we still have a greenhouse in the high school? But I don't know that every building has one. But we do work a lot with our food service program with the chef from La Crosse that comes in and does all of those things as well. And one of the leading school districts in the area as far as participation in the school lunch program. So we're in the 90% participation, if not higher. So
we just had a very positive audit at DPI of our nutritional services, and just glowing remarks that we're very proud of and the work that, that staff has done.
Well, and that farm to school program is such a great program that I try to really sing its praises when I'm on the finance committee and during budget time, because making that connection from where our food comes from and helping local farmers find a market for their food is so important. And I know I have a third grader, and he came home from school and he said, we have leaked pizza at school. We need to go to the store and get leaks, you know. So it is opening eyes to those young kids that it's fun to eat radishes or, you know, what a rutabaga is or something that maybe seems a little bit foreign, but that farm to school program and those chefs coming in and doing great things and interacting with the kids to make it fun and that nutrition is really key.
We also, I know that the additional credits for math and science that they're either approved or are looking at, I know we have some concerns about those as you talk about the increased dollars that we get. Obviously, that may take additional staffing and those sorts of things, and funded mandates, you know, that come down again. It may seem like we get more money, but we have more students, and because of the 3-year time frame that we actually, until we fully get funded for a student, that can really put a strain on us. And as we have to build new schools, our mill rate is about $2 higher than area schools, and that's all allocated towards our, pretty much to our debt for those buildings. So if we wouldn't have to build those buildings, we'd be right there with the other school districts as far as our mill rate. But we can attribute that almost to the T for that. I would also mention that nationally certified teachers, we have the highest number of those in the area, including competitive school districts that have many more teachers. And each year we add a good number of those, so highly trained professional staff in the district. And then something that I don't know if you've heard about, but there's this community collaborative group that's meeting, and it's got representation from the town of Holland, the town of Onalaska, and the school district, and the village of Holman. And we're really working at identifying and establishing a youth center connected to the school. That's the current site that we're looking at, and some of the townships are actually going to have a referendum question in April related to supporting the school and the building of that building. And and the village is looking at providing funding. And it's very unique to do something like that with all these governmental agencies, entities together. So, you know, we might be tugging at your ear to see if there's anything that you might be able to do on a statewide level to help us and to use this as a model. I know my home school, Cashton, had a referendum where they are building, the school district is building a bill, adding on, and part of that is for community fitness. Norwalk is doing the same thing. Norwalk, Ontario, Wilton, they are adding on for community fitness kind of programming. And so with the whole idea of fitness and better health and wellness and those sorts of things, it's just kind of a new and I think trend to be looking at those things in collaboration with school districts. So I just
want, I think one of the previous meetings I was at, I think that group came and gave you an update.
Yep.
Wershoven.
Yeah, Mary Lynn Wershoven,
yeah,
and Lori Kessler,
yeah,
and
so
Dan McHugh.
That's exciting, and
yeah.
I actually brought this up last week. There was a group from Waupaca County in a leadership conference that came to talk to me about some youth services. And in Waupaca, they don't have big brothers, big sisters in services in Appleton, or they don't have a boys and girls club. So they were kind of thinking creatively on this project and trying to get started next, you know, and actually get you in touch with some people in Coleman area that are kind of looking to service youth and look for some mentoring things, but also really make it a really exciting community program for many generations to act with them and interact with. So
yeah, it's not just the youth, I should say. It's a multi-generational, so we would have services for seniors during the day, a place for them to come, possibly do the meals, that kind of thing in that area, and then possible activities for them as well, so multi-generational.
Yeah, good.
Yeah, but just wanted to share those few things with you too about Holman and what we're doing. Very proud of the district. So, so any other comments or questions? Otherwise, will you kind of let Jennifer get on her way so she can prepare for her travels?
Well, always feel free to email me. I do a e-electronic newsletter, so about twice a month my staff is on an electronic newsletter, so feel free to sign up for that and kind of recap some things happening in the 30 seconds and where I've been and what's going on, but also bills that are being introduced. So if you want to kind of follow along, I know we've got a school start date change bill that LPC even had a hearing, but that's one that sometimes comes up when I talk to school districts about pending legislation as well. So feel free to always contact me, and I'm always happy to appear up here before you as well. And I just want to say, Mr. Trivett, congratulations for being a student representative. That you have a big responsibility in front of you, and I know that you have the skills to do it, that you have the confidence of many, and I think it's really inspiring to see young people who want to be involved in the, at the school district level, serving on your school board, and who knows, that you could be a future state senator, state governor, or something that with the policy that you're becoming familiar with. So congratulations, I'm really glad to see your interest.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much,
thank you,
Jennifer. Okay, then moving on, reports and discussion. The first item will be Viking Investment Fund and representative from Business Services and the
Chris and Amy are gonna get it started off.
Last 3 years since kids have taken the personal finance ago, we got together, we sat down, we began talking with the Blackwood Falls School District, this gentleman there named Chris Rabel. About 15 years ago, they got a grant from a private citizen to the $250,000, and the money was earmarked specifically for an investment club for students to run and operate and manage. In the last 15 years, the club is completely run by students, they make all the decisions, they invest all the money, and needless to say, they've actually never lost money in the last 15 years, which is impressive considering the stock market years of lives. So we've been talking with them, and what we're going to propose tonight is really a hybrid version of what we think would work for us, but it's based off of something that's already been in process for about the last 15 years. So, as I said, induction staff, hi. So the purpose of the club, the way that we're looking to operate this is the biggest thing that Amy and I do is teach. Education should be behind everything that we do. We're hoping to start a fund with your permission and your blessings where kids can raise money since we don't have a donation of $50,000 to start with. We were looking to raise funds and use that money to actually let the students invest with real world money. We think this is going to give kids a lot of opportunity to invest in stock spots, mutual funds, things like that, and see how the financing operates. And then one of the last pieces of the puzzle that we're hoping to instill in some of the kids is the philanthropy or the charitable side. Every year, what we're hoping to do with this money that's raised and invested in will increase in value is to give back to the high school, to give back to the school districts. Let kids, let teachers, let groups, let organizations write proposals for money for various things. If band needs a new tuba, if the track team needs hurdles or whatever it is, we understand that money is very tight, and we're hoping to give back some of the profits that we have. Funds to teach kids and what to give back. So that's the purpose of the fund. I think that you'll agree that the cause is one worth celebrating. We would like to fundraise for this because we really have a lot of ways of getting funds. I know that the community Pullman is very active, very involved, and very supportive of a lot of the things the school district does. We would hope to fundraise outside the school day. I know that there's a few opportunities that kids have expressed interest in. Raffles at the basketball games. Mount Olympus Day, I know that certain school districts allow kids to go to Mount Olympus for $5 and then $1 goes to the cause. But we were hoping that these student organized and student run. The next piece of the puzzle then is how we operate on a day-to-day basis. We would hope that there would be a 5-year grace period where we can allow the club and organization to raise money, to raise funds. $5,000 per year is a lot of people, but I think with the students that we have, it's more than reasonable. After 5 years, if we have $25,000, we would use that as the baseline for investing. After that, after we've kind of gotten our bearings and kind of know what's going on, in order to allow the fund to continue to grow, we would like to take half of the profits every year. And as I said earlier, give back to the school of Pullman, the high school particularly. And then the other half of the money would be used to reinvest in the funds. If it's a bad year, if kids are experiencing tough times, then that might just be a year we have to go without donations to the organizations. So we'll go quickly through this because I know Amy and I deal with this every day, and you guys know this already. What we're trying to do does tie to state and national standards. You can see everything that we would do in the organization, analyzing charts, reading investment tables, things like that, are all things that we'd be doing in the classroom already. So we feel like we're not trying to do anything that isn't already it's covered in the classroom. We're just trying to find a different way, maybe a better way to relate what we're talking about to the real world experience of what our kids can learn at high school. So in the process right now, I think that for the last year, Amy and I have been trying to formulate how we can get this to work out. For the last 6 months, we've been working with Jay Clark, Mr. Miller, reading through the board policy of are there any hiccups, are there any things that might says investments that have very low risk of loss or principal. Obviously, when that policy was written, your funds, and obviously you're not going to take the board funds and invest in the stock market because that would be crazy. So I think that the Finance Committee meets next Monday, and we would like your blessing, your permission to look at possibly changing or making an exception to that policy, where if the money is used for education purposes or run by students or however it would be written, if we could obviously invest in things that are not very low risk of funds at all. So we would like to answer any questions you have, and maybe see the next steps of moving forward with this idea.
Questions?
I'd like to take the class myself.
At parent teacher conferences, it's rather funny because I get parents all the time that say, you know what, I really wish that they would have taught this when I was going through these things that have been taxed.
Oh, yes, yes. I think it's very important. It's one thing I think the kids need more of, and that's learning how to balance a checkbook and how to do budgets and notice what and have know that when they make investments like that, that there's results to what they invest.
Yep.
I think it's a great idea, yeah.
And the thing that Amy and I found is that when they take the class, they realize they like it more than they thought they would.
Oh, yes, I can imagine. And it kind of attacks their competitive side too.
Absolutely.
You know.
We play stock market games in there, and they do not like losing. So.
Do you talk much about debt?
We do.
And like the whole risk of debt. You know, when you're a young person, it's so easy to just take that, get a new credit card, and want to like, whoa.
And that's a huge thing too, because the kids, I think, hear about credit cards, they know what credit is, but they don't really understand the implications of it. And
yeah.
So what you're recommending is a separate club?
That's one of the things we've been kind of playing with. We would like to start an organization. We're not seeking any compensation from the activities fund or from. We would just like to incorporate a lot of the things in the club within the classroom.
Mm-hmm.
So as far as a co-curricular club in that sense, no, we're not looking to do that. But we would like to, when we're talking about stocks investing and things like that, rather than teaching it
having some real life experience. I know that many organizations, especially nonprofits, will establish investment policies that will not necessarily say allow you to not invest in any low or high risk kind of thing, but they will do the percentages. And maybe if you came with a concrete, maybe your students could help establish that policy for your club. And then I would think that the Finance Committee, if they had something more concrete like that to respond to, instead of saying, well, we want to be able to invest in these high risk things. Well, how much of the money is going to be spent in that? So if that might be helpful, I think, in moving it along. And I guess that's just my perception.
And it's funny you say that, because Blackbird Falls does have a very clear set of, it's not day trading. Not trying to do anything that is crazy. There's predominantly blue chip, very safe, very conservative stocks that just tend to do well over time. And they do have certain percentage benchmarks that they're not allowed to absolutely.
That might be helpful, Jay. Would that be helpful to your group as you're moving this along to have something
yes.
like that?
Sure.
And then, I would think that if people knew up front that this what the money was being raised for and being used for, there's that understanding. Some people don't want to donate if it's possibly going to be lost. I think that's going to be key too. So having some answers to those questions might help with that, moving that along. But certainly to accommodate being able to have some, it's different when you do it with play money than it is when you're actually using money to make those kind of investments. So
I don't know if it's possible or not for the Finance Committee, but I was just thinking, would it be possible to have your group come talk at the Finance Committee to speak more if there's like questions or, I don't know what you think, other people on the committee, but.
We have a meeting next Monday.
Yeah. I guess the question is the board supportive of them
oh, yes.
doing something? So,
yes.
So if the board's supportive, then I think you probably working with the Finance Committee can get that to work.
And
so.
Since I'm always a grammar Nazi, if you're strictly looking at number two, the word principal up here, I mean,
do you want to
did you write
you
that? There is Okay, because I was going to say, you could get away with it. This is a principle up here, doesn't mean money.
Yeah, happy to direct you from the board policy.
Oh, my. Oh, my.
Nita shouldn't have brought it.
It's verbatim.
Way to go, Nita.
Boy. Who's in charge of that one?
Go for it, go nuts.
So we're going to have a bunch of Wolves of Wall Street coming up there.
But this is great.
Yeah.
I think it's a great idea.
I think it's really out of the box.
It is.
I think it's very cool, and to get the kids involved.
And at home, we've always been ahead of the curve as far as financial literacy education goes, so.
And you might be able to, instead of just relying on 50-50 raffles and those kind of things, some of your partners that we have now might be willing to do this, the foundation, I'm thinking some of, you know, there's the bank in the school, those kind of things might be willing to support you to at least give you that nudge up front. But they would probably also want to see a little bit more written out, detailed on those investment policies before they're going to do that, but, yeah.
I'm sure you've talked to him, but I think it's probably right in Nick Weber's wheelhouse too, so.
He's been a very good resource for this.
Yeah, I bet he has, yeah.
Yeah, so I thank you very much for coming and presenting, and it sounds like the board is supportive of this, so we look forward to continued progress on it.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Just a point of clarification then for the finance committee. There would be no need to come back to the board for a philosophical review. I feel like we've received some philosophical input tonight. Could we consider that good, or would you like to?
A good point, Jay. Is there any other further discussion philosophically about this too?
Nope.
Thank you.
I think the feeling is just that it's not just be lofty, that it's not out there, that there be a little bit more detail in what the investment policies might be.
And understand, Chris and Amy and I and Ben have talked about the possibility of a separate policy, potentially, as opposed to modifications in the district's investment policy to really deal with the instructional. So we don't know which way that'll go, but I don't want you to be surprised if you see, in fact, a separate policy as opposed to modifications to the existing.
Great, thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Okay, then co-curricular agreement renewals.
Mr. Engler.
Mr. Engler. I have Bob on this too, but he's just sitting in the audience tonight, so.
Just a reminder, I am Mark Engler, and I'm the activities director here for the school district. And my purpose of being here is to renew three different athletic programs that are co-ops. First one that we will be looking at is the girls hockey program. It's a co-op between Onalaska, Aquinas, Holman, Melrose, Monroe, and West Salem in the past. Melrose this year does not have any athletes as part of the program, but I thought I might include them because it's a two-year renewal, just in case they had kids that would want to be part of the program in the second year. I think we've had a very successful program. The girls' program in recent years has done very well through season and going into tournament time. We have six girls this year on the Holman team, seven from Onalaska, three from Aquinas, and two from West Salem. So we have strong participation in terms of the overall program. The boys hockey program is a co-op between Aquinas, GDP Holman, and Cotton Fountain City. And like the girls' program, Cotton Fountain City does not have any athletes on the team. But again, I thought that might include them at this point, just in case they're in the second year, they would like to be part of it. We also have very strong representation here. Holman has 12 athletes on this team, Aquinas has 8, and GDP has 4. We have the largest portion of that co-op program. Between the boys and girls program, if you remember, we went through a process of finding a way to create a more balanced way of supporting the boys and girls program through a lot of communication between parent reps and ADs from other school districts. We were able to do that, and we feel like that's going fairly well this year. And I think for the most part, parents understand that process and are supportive of it. So I think that's been successful. And then lastly, we have the girls' swim program, which is a co-op between districts. We have a fairly strong program that does bring swimmers to state on a regular basis. This year we had two relay teams make it to state, took 11 from 13, and I think we had one unweighted place in two different individual events. So three very good programs that I think are working within the co-op situation, and we're looking to renew them for the 14-15 and 15-16 school years.
Are there questions? The district expense on both the hockey, it, you know, they are the same, but it's quite substantial. Is that similar to other co-op programs that we have? I think it's $7,000 for each of the programs, is that correct?
I would say that in terms of the amount of money that's being spent to keep the Cal Booster Club support, that hockey's a little bit more expensive. I would say that hockey and football are probably the most expensive sports per athlete. Probably hockey would be even a little bit more than football. The amount of money that goes towards ice time is substantial. And it's a fairly expensive sport, and also the equipment is quite expensive. So it is one of the more expensive sports.
Any other questions? And this is...
Yeah, on the consent for the next board meeting.
For the next board meeting, and it's not on tonight. So if you have any questions between now and that time, Dr. Carlson would be happy to answer them. Otherwise, thank you, Mark. I just want to say thank you. I have observed and heard much about the amount of time that you're putting in the district, and just to let you know how much it's appreciated. I've personally seen that and have heard other stories of people seeing you at everything and late nights and early mornings, and just, you know, it is a tough job that you have, especially in our district where it combines the middle school and the high school. There's a lot that's being expected of you, and just want you to know how much we appreciate all the efforts that you do. So.
Thank you. I enjoy being at the events. It's tough to make them all. But
yeah. Great. Well, thank you very much. Thanks for your efforts. Okay, then moving on to digital, if I can say this, the transition plan.
Both Jan and Wendy are going to come up. And
what did Wendy do? What did she do to her foot?
We do turn on the wireless when we have big events. So when we have the wrestling,
bring some of our computers up to date, better desktop. We're not talking about mobiles here, we're talking about the desktops. And so with the need for use of those desktop computers in the lab, film projects and for assessment, we decided to take a portion of those dollars up to 5 computer labs. I don't know if you know this, but there are 20 computer labs across the district. There are 7 in the high school, 5 in the middle school, 1.5 in Evergreen, 2 in the other elementaries. So we have a lot of computers in the computer lab, and that was a really important need. And we did that over the Christmas holidays. So we're getting good reports from our teachers who are using the labs right now, saying what a difference that makes to have new computers in the lab. So that was one of the parts of the plan. And Wendy's going to talk to you about the professional development program itself.
So to use the technology effectively within the classroom, we thought it would be very important to have ongoing professional development. We started with a group of 81 staff members that are pre-K-12 who have volunteered to be part of our original or first round of training. With that, we are going to provide 2 full days of staff development for this group. So these trainings will include, we will share a little bit more about Google Apps for Education, and also Tuesdays, which in our digital transition plan, we have required that besides the 2 full days that staff members participate in 4 other staff development opportunities. And our Tech Tuesdays, we think it's very important that differentiated staff development. And this, with having a Tech Tuesday and a different theme or a technology idea each Tuesday, they will have an opportunity to choose what best meets their needs and the needs of their students. We are working with Innovative Educator Consulting and C-Support to help us with the staff development. Both Janet and I have been working with both of these groups to help provide staff development for members.
And that's just a picture from one of our Google Apps for Education training, and in this case led by Tim Nielsen, who is one of the Innovative Educator people in the group. Our implementation plan includes several of these elements.
The implementation plan, the first step is to provide our educators with some mobile devices, in order to help their students use the devices. They need to have devices for themselves. So we will be adding 81 laptops for each of these educators. We have already ordered 2 carts of 31 Chromebooks for at the middle school and the high school. And right now, we are investigating what will be the best for the elementary schools. We have surveyed the staff and seen what do they feel are the best devices, but then also we surveyed them to say, how would you use the devices? So we're going to do our best to match the use of the device.
And as far as the budget, remember we have $350,000 added to the technology budget on an annual basis. And the funding for the position, the instructional technologist position, had a certain amount of dollars allocated to it that we're using for the professional development, consultant costs, and so on. So if you take a look at the budget overall, we are spending about 30% of the budget for devices for students, about 20% for our educators. The cost for the lab is about 25% of the total allocated amount. We have software licensing, charging cards, and so on that are additional costs. And then our professional development program is about 20%. An equation that I hear often cited for professional development, what portion of a budget, a technology budget, is appropriate for PD is about 20 to 25%. So I think we're right on target there.
they're also listed there.
Where is that?
It's under the departments area of our website, under Information Technology Services, and then you'll see in the menu Digital Transition Professional Development Program. So, I would like to answer any questions if you have any.
Any questions?
I have a question about the labs. There's 20 labs total, and you've done five so far. Is there like a projected plan to like chip away at the rest of those, or is there a need right now? I didn't remember what you said, if you said anything about that specifically, but are you?
At this point, there's not a plan to replace all of our labs. We're in a transition, though we need desktop computers in our labs, and every one of those remaining labs, that's a discussion that's ongoing. We have curriculum labs, our business ed labs, our art lab, and so on. And so, yes, it is likely that we're going to need to maintain those computers. We need three general labs in high school. As we transition towards a mobile environment, increasing access for our students, we need to reassess that. So at this point, that's all on the discussion. As far as funding dollars, that's also a topic of, very high-level discussions with Dr. Carlson and Jay and Wendy and the work leadership team. So they are definitely in need of updating if we were going to continue to support them.
You mentioned the two full days of staff development. Is that going to take place in the summer, during the school year, or has that taken place?
The two days are going to take place during the school year, so that as they're getting the devices, they're up and running with them, now, so they're being sent to their kids. So they've been spread out. We did have one in November, we have another one coming up Wednesday, and another one in February.
This was one of those discussions that because we're so sensitive to taking our teachers out of the classroom, but it's that balance of, we think this is a good thing. It will be good for our staff and our students, and so and to keep it moving forward and the timing a little bit, so this won't necessarily be for the future and the way we continually do this. We'll look for us other opportunities too, but for right now, we think it's going to pay off in that balance. So, but it is still a tough decision to make.
But you take them out, do it in the summer, and then they sit all summer without any use of it. It makes no sense to do that, but there is an added cost to doing that that way. So I'm glad that you thought that through. So any other?
The trainer part, is that like, is it a whole new, it's someone coming out in from contracted position to do the training? I was assuming that the training will be kind of heavy-handed on the onset of things, and then will it kind of decrease, or is that just going to be a continuous level of training, and you just don't know?
As they mentioned again, we have repurposed some of those dollars to help us contract out at this point to get this moving along.
We're also building in a Google Apps for Education certification opportunity for 15 of our educators. So once we have some lead educators in the building who are certified, they too have a commitment to provide additional training. And we'll have some experts in this. And our LMC staff is great about helping. A lot of outreach training. Some of them may wish to do that as well.
Great. Any other questions?
We had a long discussion on letting the students use their own devices in the school district, and I kind of lost track of where that is. Where are we with that?
So at this point, the last time that we had a discussion
I like, personally, my own personal opinion is I'd like to open it up and let them use their own devices if they're compatible. And I'd also like to have the Wi-Fi. I like to travel around to other school districts, you know. I turn on my telephone and I pick up their Wi-Fi like that. And I think that's something we should have at home and in the evenings and the weekends maybe to start with. I heard you say they have large, but you know, I'll be at a basketball game or something or some event and somebody will, they'll always come to me and say, hey, what's the password for middle school? I said, I don't know, they won't give it to me. But I think we should be able to use that. But I'm still an advocate of, to that point, there's a lot of kids out there that would be a big help if they could bring their laptops or their tablets. I mean, even my grandkids, even the ones that are 6, 7, 8 years old, seem like they have tablets now and use them better than I can.
And wasn't there like a proposal for a pilot?
We did one.
The pilot, and so based on that, it just was not. I know there were a lot of questions, like a lot of questions people had. But
there's
mm-hmm. 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 The software and the hardware, everything changes so fast. And if we talked about it 6, 7 months ago, it might be a whole entire different conversation today than it was half a year ago. So we should stay on top of that, I think. And cause it makes sense to me if it's safe for everyone and everybody's comfortable with it.
Very intent that we continue to have this vision of really moving forward to coming close to that ratio of what we've talked about is a 1-to-1, whatever that looks like, whether that means students and staff have it, take it with them 24/7, or at least that ratio. We're still marching, want to march forward to that, and we have, as a board, have had some discussion and communication related to cost with that. This is an ongoing step forward, but as we've talked even most recently with our goals, our financial goals, that to achieve some level of a 1-to-1, for example, we will need to have ongoing conversation in our budgeting of how to achieve that. And that is, in some ways, part tied into that fiscal sustainability goal discussion that we have had and we will continue to have. So, but for right now, we believe this is a positive step and and a necessary step, especially bringing along our staff who really need to be out there leading this. And they're key. They're so key to the success of this program. Before we just continue to put devices in the hands of our students, we need our staff out there in front of it. So I want to thank these two and also the principals that they've worked with and the teachers, and also the teachers, as you talked about, who have stepped forward and are willing to lead this in many ways. So anyway,
I'd like to also say that the website gets better and better all the time too. It's getting more and more information on it. It's cleaner and cleaner and nice.
And
sorry.
I can say today that the search is working.
Kate, did you have? I was actually going to ask what Gary asked, so I'm not going to go into that. But then the second thing I wanted to say was I remember, I think the first time I met you, Jan, was my orientation as a new school board member. And you were sharing with me, I think at that time the plan was maybe 5 years old, but it just hadn't been able to be acted on. And I remember sitting there saying pretty many times, are you serious? Not because of anything you didn't do, just in wonderment at the district of Holman, which is so ahead of so many areas, but in technology not. Well, let it just be said, that was a really short time ago. And the leaps that have happened due to administration, due to all of your leadership, is amazing to me. From hardware to networking to professional development, it's really night and day. And also to the board, you know, for supporting this. And I love seeing the wave that we're on now. And I feel that there is a belief on the public's behalf and on the board's behalf and everyone's behalf that this is a worthy cause. This is really, really important. So just thank you for all that. And just a reminder that so much has exploded in 2 years. And, you know, like when we were talking about Mark's long hours, I can only imagine our IT department's long hours that we'll never know. And the problem solving they've done. So just thank everyone that I'm not naming names of right now for
do
us.
Do you email Jen like on a weekend at 2 when everybody else is like doing something fun and Jen knows back at 15?
There you go.
Yep. I'm supposed to read that. I'm like Cullen, I'm always connected.
Yeah. It's amazing. It's just amazing what has happened in this district. And
is, I just don't want to let Gary's point drop. And the and as Dr. Carlson pointed out, the 1-to-1 ratio, there is a financial investment that we would have to make, especially if we said we want to have it next year. I mean, that would be huge. But I think as a board, the majority from my recollection is interested in how can we get that then if we aren't going to make 100% infrastructure. Is there a way that we could do that through the bring your own device? And if not, if their feeling is we're not going to expand the bring your own device, then how many years is it going to be between now and 2 years, 3 years before we get to that 1-to-1? I would certainly think the bring your own device could move that up a lot sooner.
I would think.
And
but could you actually guarantee that the people who bring their own device will be compatible with our device that we're?
If it's not compatible, then that would be one less person that.
Would that be up to the individual to make it compatible so that it would fit in?
I agree.
And we didn't have wireless, so it didn't make sense to have them bring wireless devices because there was no ability to access that. But that's kind of what's changed, is the infrastructure has now changed. And so certainly would be great discussion, and I think you would find a board that would be positively responsive to that. And if a student doesn't have a device that is compatible, that would just be one more student we would have to look to providing a device for. But if 1-5 bring a device that is compatible, those are 5 less items that we have to buy them. And so that's where it could move along a lot faster.
You get the kids, like I've got some grandkids that are 8, 9 years old, and when they get around me, they'll say, Papa, will you hotspot your phone so I can use my... It just boggles my mind when they say stuff like that. And I say, okay, fine. You know, I turn on and they go on Wi-Fi.
Yeah.
But they'll find a Wi-Fi someplace. You know how they are.
Helen.
I want to first echo the use of technology in the school. From a student's perspective, having the ability to have bring in even your own devices or just have mobile laptops and everything is crucial for the classroom. It seems to use really effectively. When kids bring their own devices in, not necessarily connecting it to our Wi-Fi, but just using it for having a Word document or making a PowerPoint, it's really useful for class presentations and just continuing on making sure that students are technology savvy, because it's always growing, it's getting bigger, and it's trying to keep up. But I did have a question with this. We were going through the digital transition and professional development plan. Could you go over a little bit what the Google Apps for Education training is all about? I saw there was a big point about that. Do we have any teachers right now that are certified with that?
We do not have any certified educators yet, but we will have. Google Apps for Education has become a massive trend across the country in terms of moving away from the use of Microsoft Office suite of tools, Word, PowerPoint, and so on. Those are for cost. You have to pay licensing, volume licensing, $28,000 to the school district. Many districts made the choice to move into the Google world. You can use Google tools freely, anyone can. So any one of you, anyone in the audience can go out and get a Google account, right? But now we have our own domain that we manage, and we create accounts for our students and for our staff. Every student in our district will have an account that's third grade and up. All of our teachers will have an account. They will be able to go out there and create their documents, their presentations, work with the drawing tools, their Excel-like tools, a spreadsheet tool, Word, their slideshow tools. They'll be able to share their documents and work collaboratively. Their teachers will be able to actually monitor and see the work that their students are doing and give help through the use of comments and peer editing and so on. So we really need to move down the world where it's cloud-based, where students can go home and get their files at any time, not worry about them sitting on our servers. And that's the route that many have gone. And we need to move away from print, everything being printed. I get emails from kids from the high school going, Mrs. Lee, I think you should come here and see the bounds of paper that are sitting in the boxes that have been printed that, you know, are not, it's a waste. Today's world, teachers can, once they learn how to use Google Apps, can move more digital and do the editing, the grading, the input, feedback. The workflow is different in Google Apps than it is in Word. So we see that as a win-win, and so there are many teachers across Wisconsin have moved to Google Apps for Education.
And I think a big part, you know, with kids with the Common Core is also kids collaborating and working together. And that's something with the Google Apps that can happen. The document that they're working on can be shared together, and they can each add their piece, and there's amazing things that it will, you know, cite where you receive, you know, information from. So there's so much that is available within Google that's not even within the document.
And I'm sure it'll change again in a year.
Okay, well, great. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, then moving on to board member reports and discussion. I'll call. Anticipated spaces, Julie. Yep, anticipated spaces for new open enrollment.
She's been waiting so patiently there.
I saw her get
up. You know
when you're getting to the end
of the new month.
Let's move on. Request to the middle school and high school, the number of slots available is open. We will consider all open enrollment requests and grant those requests which do not cause undue financial burden to the district. New approved requests could result in an increase in sections and overall staffing at middle school and high school. A note that I wanted to bring up is that special education students requesting open enrollment into the district who currently are in programs that are self-contained, either at the elementary or at the high school, could be denied that their open enrollment request because we do not have such programming at elementary or high school at this time. A reminder that at the four-year-old kindergarten level, two sections equals one FTE. At the kindergarten level, one section equals one FTE. In a final note, it's important to note here that the calculation that we use to determine the open enrollment capacity is different from the calculation that we use to determine the number of sections per grade level at a specific building. And so that could result in a different projected total number of sections. It looks like, as I create this chart, I need to put my box at the bottom of the machine. I see that it's hard to read it here. Questions?
Are there any questions?
I have a question about open enrollment for special education students outside of the district wanting to come into Holman and are interested in the alternative ed programs out on the prairie. So, and they are receiving special education services for, let's say, EBD, and they are in a program that's setting outside of the school, a typical school setting in one of the other districts, but those settings don't seem to fit the need. I mean, our Holman district has some pretty cool things going on out in the prairie, and people are kind of hearing about it and talking about it and wondering, would that be something that would be an opportunity for my child, or would, you know, where are we at with that as far as if we capacity and expanding more opportunities for open enrollment for people to come in from outside the district for those? Right.
These are Holman High School students. They would be accepted into Holman High School.
Right.
Once they're here, we determine, is the Academy on the Prairie the right place for them?
Okay.
So that would be the process. They would be accepted into the district.
Okay.
First. And
gotcha.
Once we get to know them, we would determine if the Academy is the appropriate placement. You're talking special education students particularly. The Academy isn't just special ed. It isn't just special ed.
Sure. Sure. I'm just thinking that's kind of the folks that I've run into that have kind of special identified education needs that haven't been able to really find the right fit either in a special education setting in the school or more of a outside of the school contained setting. And some of the things that are happening out on the prairie are like pretty unique, and students are talking too. And I just think it sounds pretty appealing, that opportunity that could really allow for a lot of success, especially when several of the groups came and talked about their experiences of what their experience was when they weren't there, and now they're there, and they're having all these opportunities and success. So
Julie, am I hearing that as we continue to evaluate and assess the Academy, because it's fairly new,
mm-hmm.
We want to make sure that it's has a solid foundation before we look at really expanding. But I would say, too, always open to refer questions, interests. Would best place in this case, what you're hearing, should start with you?
Me, and Bob.
Okay. So, like, identifying the need, even. Like, if there's an interest or outside, be interested to know.
I do get calls.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I get similar calls from Project Live.
Yes. Right.
Programming and,
right.
So, you know, as we build that and continue to grow it, all those things will be different.
Okay. Thanks.
I wanted to add, and you may have remembered a year ago, I talked about the middle school specifically. And you'll note on here that we have that pretty much open. And I have to say, though, that, and Mr. Vogler's here too, that we've had recent conversations, ongoing conversations about a particular grade level. Because of how it's structured at the middle school and our house concept and so on, when you approach that upper 200 number, it gets very challenging to accommodate the choices and what our students want and so on. So we're aware of that. I know Mr. Vogler, and along with Julie, closely monitor what we're projecting. Even if we start the school year out with an okay number, throughout that first semester, we see things increase, and Ryan's there really working hard to try to figure out how we can make this work. And so far, we've been able to do it. But there's going to come a time, and I know Mr. Vogler is studying that and looking at that with his staff. Eventually, we're going to have to figure out how we're going to go over that 300 per grade level. Where does open enrollment come in? Again, we're still not at the place that we're going to close the door, but it's an issue for us that we have to address, and especially the middle school. And then, as Julie noted, and what's said too, at the elementary, we have these open slots or our projections. That does not guarantee, though, that at a particular elementary school and at a particular grade level that we would necessarily be open. As we revisit our within school district choice requests and our placements. So just this is district wide, not per building.
Any questions?
I have one more question. You're saying that who needs self-contained programming? Are we talking about the standard IEP?
No, there are some students, a very small handful of students, who need a much more restrictive environment and might need to be in the classroom with a very restrictive one teacher. At this point, we do not have that. We work on a holistic type model.
This isn't necessarily just learning disabled.
There are much more significantly disabled students. Yeah.
So this is on your will be on your consent for the next board meeting.
Okay, thank you. Then we are ready to move on to board member reports and discussions. I'll call on board members in order of the roll call and ask that you present any comments or committee reports that you may have. Mr. Trivett.
All right, again, I'd just like to reiterate how happy I am to see that the district is moving forward, advancing with technology and trying to get into the hands of students and work with it in the classroom. It's always good to see just taking the technology step forward, especially if we've been behind in the past years. So, and then also just like to congratulate all the sports teams that have been going on all throughout the winter, gymnastics, basketball, wrestling. And just this past weekend, DECA had their district competition up at UW-Stout. And we had 94 students go, and we had 84 medals and a lot of placings. So, did very well there.
Okay, thank you very much. Lisa Collins.
I guess I just want to say that I'm looking forward to the WASB convention in Milwaukee next week and traveling in a large size van with several other members. Should be interesting. And I'm the delegate for the district, and that means that I'm voting on proposed resolutions, and I had a chance to look at the big packet and try to decipher a lot of that and talk to Kate about it because she's on the resolutions committee, so it was neat. So I am really looking forward to that. It'll be a neat experience. So.
Thank you, Lisa. Mr. Dunlap.
Just like to wish everyone a happy new year and busy times at the school district. There's lots and lots and lots of things to see and do out there. Encourage everybody to get out there. I'd like to give my condolences to Aaron Johnson's family. They really touched our community the last 6 months or so, and we're gonna feel that loss for a long time. And also we have Finance Committee meeting next Monday, and you're all invited.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Joe, Mr. Gittins?
No comments.
Okay. Mrs. Jagodinski,
I attended the Personnel and Governance Committee meeting last week, and unfortunately had to chair the committee because Cheryl was absent. I don't like running meetings.
It got done early, though.
You're great at that, Anita. You are so good at that.
We talked a lot about the health insurance plan. We went over some administrative rules and policies. And had about, I can forward some notes on the show, but had a little wrap set up. I will also be attending the WASB convention next week. And I'm happy to say that next week is gonna be the first time since, okay, I got on the board in 97, and I've gone to every WASB convention except one, and next week is the first time I'm ever gonna be able to attend the Friday of the WASB convention, because West Salem did not have school. So I am so excited.
Anita, I'm excited about you and Cheryl teaching me how to get all the goodies at the booths. Apparently, you guys know how to, you're very skilled at getting all the collectible things from each one.
A bag a day.
Yeah. And like, I'd like to echo what Gary said. I'd like to extend my condolences not only to Aaron Johnson's family, but to the whole Evergreen family. Just a very, very sad time in our district, and unfortunately we seem to have quite a few of those, so my condolences to the staff and the family of Aaron Johnson. And that's all I have.
Okay, thank you. Mrs. Mayor, Kate.
Just to piggyback on what Dale said about Mike Gasper, I ran into one of our food service staff the day before the audit was coming and the pressure that was on them, and then to read how well they did. So thank you, Mike, and every single person that works for us in the food service. With the snow and the ice, I have a lot of friends that live out in the country here, so I travel ice-covered roads a lot, and I always think of our bus drivers and how they safely get our kids to and from, because there's some really slick places out there. And with the slickness, also buildings and grounds, it's a safe place to walk in the sidewalks. I did attend Aaron Johnson's funeral on Saturday. And my condolences too, but I also wanted to say what you guys have already said. Rob, Aaron's dad, wrote a letter speaking to Aaron as his eulogy, and the theme of the letter was a thank you. And the very first people he thanked were his teachers and his principal, and there were tons of them there. And I watched Aaron's kids come up and hug those people, and they hugged them back, and just a sincere thank you and an acknowledgement of what our teaching staff does that goes above and beyond data and Common Core. It's our teachers and our staff who go into this business because they care about kids, and they made a difference in Aaron's life. And Justine and Rob and Aaron really appreciated that, and Sister Anna as well.
And Mr. Menninger is absent. I guess I just want to echo the condolences to the Johnson family. And my granddaughter, I didn't realize, she came home on Friday and said she should have worn yellow because they were telling them to wear yellow that day.
Yeah.
She didn't wear yellow, and she was sad about that. But then she wrote a little note, and in whatever a kindergartner language that was, it was kind of all over the place. But I said, well, I'm sure that would just make him feel better. And so she wore yellow over the weekend and in his honor, too. So I know that the Evergreen family under Joanne's leadership has just been wonderful. And the high school students I know that were working for him were impacted, too. And I talked to someone at the high school about making sure that they were making sure that everybody that had been touched by this family was being serviced in an appropriate way. So it's just nice to know, and it just reminds you that every day, every student matters. And I think that we do that very well in this district. So thank you. And then just on a brighter side, congratulations to those who have taken out and decided to run again for school board. Mr. Gittins, Mr. Dunlap, Mr. Cruz, I know, have come forward to run, and I have indicated I'm going to run one more time, and that will be it. Mm-hmm. I know that it's a big deal to put your name out there to run, so I applaud you for doing that and thank you for the services that you have provided, so. Following up on the correspondence, I know the folder has gone through and there were some letters from the Forensics Association complimenting those folks for the success they had at the theater festival, and then the Wisconsin Health and Physical Education Association. A couple of our staff people went and spoke at that convention in October and thanking them for doing that. So I would just note that board meeting schedule, the 22nd of January to the 24th is the WASB conference in Milwaukee. If you haven't registered and you want to go, I'm sure we could still find a way for you to go. We have a board meeting on the 27th, Monday, February 3rd. We have that board workshop with Nat Fail again. Remember that. That's going to be working more on board interactions and professional development kind of opportunities. So that will be a great one to attend. And then our board meetings in February are the 10th and the 24th. School board election, verification of candidacy and ballot order. I would just note that the four candidates were certified. And at this time, Kate and Christina are going to do the drawing for the order of on the ballot. And I don't know if, Kate, if you have anything else to add to the certification.
No, I really don't. Everything is kosher, and that's how we like it. Congratulations, and thank you to everybody who is going to run. So there are four envelopes in this basket. I'm going to shuffle them up. It's a lovely ballot basket. Holman does it the best. And Christina is going to choose.
Number one.
I have
Thomas Cruz. And number two on the ballot is going to be Joel Giddens.
Let me guess.
Make sure he's in there.
And then the famous Gary Dunlap number four.
All right, thank you very much. Item 10.5 is WASB resolutions. As it has been mentioned, the convention part of it is the voting on resolutions. And I know you've received a copy. If there were any that you specifically wanted to take a stand on as a district, we could do that. But past practice has been just to ask our delegate to vote appropriately according to district needs and interests. So I don't know if there were any. I know one that came up was the TOMA submitted resolution related to start date.
Yes.
And that would be one certainly that we would want to support, but other than that, seeing no real interest in further discussing, Lisa, were there any that you had questions on about how the board felt, or
really? I mean, the resolutions were pretty common sense and sure. Things that were supportive of our, you know, our educational system and what we want to maintain here in Holman, and I didn't see anything that was counterintuitive. I didn't see anything in it. Just in talking to Kate, she said the resolution committee is very pro student, and so you always wonder, like, who's on the resolutions committee and who's deciding? And so since she was on it, she assured me that that was definitely, people were really thinking about kids first when they proposed those.
And those resolutions are what the School Board Association uses then to refer to when working with legislators and mm-hmm. either voting for, supporting, or against bills that come before the Wisconsin legislature. Okay, great. Well, then consent agenda items. We have the consent agenda with 9 items on them. If anyone wants to pull any item off and discuss them individually, we can do so. Otherwise, I would entertain a motion to approve as presented.
I'll make the motion to approve the consent agenda items as presented.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
And any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Then before we go into adjournment, I would just remind you, if you have not done the district administrator's evaluation, to please get those to Christina as soon as possible. That will be a closed session at our next board meeting. So we need, is there a second?
I'll second.
Discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of adjourning, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay.
Nay.
Motion carries.